Good afternoon, everyone. So I guess we should start it, right? Let's get started. So the afternoon one will be, we'll continue the morning session. So this is the second part of the numerical approach to the fluctuating magnets. So the speaker is Yasir Iqbal from Indian Institute of Technology. And let's welcome him.
Yeah, thank you, Gang, and I would like to thank the organizers for giving me this opportunity, and it's a pleasure to give the school lectures here. So I will continue on the note where Arnab left in his very nice lectures about what are the different methodological approaches that one can take to address the low energy properties in the strongly frustrated regime of many magnetic Hamiltonians, which are thought to describe either interesting physics on their own or have material applications, and therefore would permit a good synthesis between experiment and theory. So I'll start by actually just having a slide or two on traditional approaches, what people used to do in the good old days and what are their limitations. Then I'll come on to describe a very powerful, also a traditional approach, but something which has been developed systematically, a very powerful scheme of creating actually and constructing resonating valence bond wave functions in the fermionic representation, which are then can be the basis of a Monte Carlo method to extract, you know, and study variational wave functions of a different magnetic Hamiltonians. Then I'll show you the application of such a construction and method to various frustrated models which have been studied over the last decade or two, and show you some benchmarks and applications of the method. Then I'll go to another framework, namely that of the pseudo-fermion functional RG, which is in spirit not very different from a variational Monte Carlo approach in the fermionic representation, but it's sort of a good, it complements it well and overcomes some shortcomings that that a variational Monte Carlo has. And then I'll talk about some interesting three-dimensional candidate spin liquid materials that have come into prominence, and compare our findings and show you how functional RG is able to reproduce neutron scattering data to very good accuracy, and that in three dimensions. There are not actually any method besides functional RG as of now which can do a fully quantum many body calculation. So since I have the liberty and there's no next talk, so there's no upper bound, taking advantage of that, I'll try to start with a little poem. So those of you who know Urdu or can understand basic, and I've translated it, there's a little couplet I put it here, which is the spirit of my talk. So this is the dilemma facing me. The things which I don't understand very well, I have to explain now. Okay, so in the microscopic investigation of frustrated quantum magnetism, you know, this is one of the central challenges of modern condensed matter theory from a methodological point of view, that how do you actually correctly incorporate the effects of quantum fluctuations in a systematic way for Hamiltonians which have no small parameter, as do spin models for low values of spin. And this, to a large extent, remains an open question. There is no method which can claim to do it in a controlled way, right? So traditionally, in the 80s, people applied a lot of mean field approaches for quantum magnetism, such as Schwinger bosons. This approach, for example, in 3D is good at capturing magnetic order, but tend not to capture paramagnetic phases to a very good degree of accuracy. And of course, it's a mean field approach. So when you go and add fluctuations beyond mean field, the information that you get about, say, a quantum paramagnet can get drastically altered. Then, of course, you have the very powerful method in the case of when you're dealing with large spins systems, that of spin waves. And this actually gives you the first quantum corrections to the ground state energy and also the magnon spectrum. However, when you come to low values of spin, again, this is not able to give you very conclusive answers. And it's, of course, good as a starting point to get information about a magnetic, you know, ground state, but of course not reliable when you come to paramagnetic behavior. And then we have link cluster expansions, which are pioneered by Rajiv Singh and Gelfand. And there also, again, the problem comes is how to accurately capture paramagnetic behavior, which is what we are interested in. So last but not the least, as Arnab gave a very nice talk on quantum Monte Carlo, this is of course a numerically exact method. However, it suffers from the severe problem, which is known as the sign problem, fact that, and then the effect of that is that you are constrained to bipartite lattices. So by bipartite, I mean those on which the two sublattice nail order is not frustrated. Simple, a simple cubic lattice, a body-centered cubic lattice, a square lattice. And you must have no parametric frustration, so non-frustrating spin interactions. But as such, this regime is very restricted and does not allow you access to the real domain of interest, which is when you have competing interactions which frustrate the system and therefore can give you interesting novel ground states, as Yogesh showed in his talk. So the question is that we want to capture such kind of states. So the question is, can quantum fluctuations prevent long-range magnetic order? In my entire talk, when I refer to magnetic order, I'll be referring to dipolar magnetic order and not quadrupole or any higher pole. So when I say that there is no dipolar, no magnetic order, I will mean no long-range dipolar magnetic order. So there have been many theoretical suggestions. Anderson, Fazekas, and Anderson pioneered this idea and this paradigm on the triangular lattice, which was of course later shown to be magnetically ordered. And then arose the idea of the resonating valence bond paradigm, where basically the idea is that since the whole state is non-magnetic, its basic building block, the brick, should actually just be a singlet. Right? And then by Liang, Dussault, and Anderson showed that a simple RBB state is just a linear superposition of all possible singlet coverings which are resonating. This is of course a cartoon snapshot, but a typical RBB state will have different configurations with different weights and which are, have a linear superposition of singlets. This can be short range or can be long ranged. So what is the problem that we are having in Monte Carlo? Just to elaborate on that further and to motivate it, is that standard stochastic numerical techniques will actually avoid this numerical instability, which is famously called a sign problem, only if it is possible that you find a basis in which all the off-diagonal elements of the Hamiltonian are non-positive. If you're able to find such a basis, then you can actually do direct sampling and get numerically exact results. Indeed, if you take a quantum antiferromagnet on a bipartite lattice, like a square lattice, then you can show that on one of the sublattices, you can do this unitary transformation, U dagger, which is just exponential of e to the power minus I pi and summation over the SZs over all the B sublattices, such that the Hamiltonian is transformed within a basis, let's say X, where the off-diagonal elements are all non-positive, and you can actually do Monte Carlo and get some quantities. The ground state, of course, when you take this unitary transformation, then has all positive amplitudes, implying that there's a purely bosonic representation of the ground state, and therefore you can do. However, if you want to construct a prescription for the sign structure of these amplitudes, you can do it by the Marshall-Pearl sign rule, which tells you that the phases of the ground state of H are basically minus 1 to the power n up x, where n up is the number of electrons in one, up electrons in one sublattice. However, in the regime of strong frustration, people showed in the 90s that the Marshall-Pearl sign rule is violated quite dramatically. And you can actually have ground state wave functions which has non-trivial phases. And since there appears no analogous sign rule, it's almost impossible to do and apply this kind of sign sampling, and then you are basically left in the dark, where you must somehow try to figure how can I construct a ground state wave function with non-trivial phases. Okay, so this fact that you can have non-trivial phases is in some sense actually a manifestation of the high degree of frustration, and we will address and see how variational wave functions are constructed from a very educated way where you are able to get systematically the different structures that are allowed on a lattice. So let's start with the very famous representation of spin models, which has been used since a very long time and forms the basis of many approaches, which is basically to do a fermionic representation of a spin 1/2 particle. So all of you know that in the SU2 Abrikosov fermionic representation for spin 1/2, you can rewrite the spin operators at every site in terms of these pseudo fermions, which are spin 1/2 quasi particles, and they carry no charge. And then they follow the standard fermionic algebra. And for a model with one spin per site, like the original Heisenberg model, this of course has a redundancy in the sense that you now have also the Hilbert space has empty sites and doubly occupied sites, and one must take care of that in order to have a bona fide wave function, something legitimate which lives in the correct Hilbert space, and therefore you must impose this constraint of one fermion per site. The second interesting thing is that the standard symmetry of the Heisenberg model is just SU2 spin rotations globally, along with lattice symmetries and time reversal. In the fermionic representation, you are endowed with an additional symmetry. And that symmetry is basically an SU2 local gate symmetry, which means that at every site, you can do some transformation among the fermion doublet, which keeps the physical spin operator at every site invariant. And therefore, since it acts internally on the spin operators, it's a trivial symmetry in that sense, and therefore becomes a gate symmetry. Right? This symmetry actually was realized, its power was realized about 2 decades after the method was proposed by Xiaogang Wen in 2002, when he was able to exploit this additional symmetry in the fermionic representation to do a systematic classification of quantum spin liquids with different low energy gate structures. So this seems redundant, but is very powerful. And we will see how this constraint is taken into account. So without breaking the SU2 spin symmetry, the standard procedure is that when you rewrite the spins in terms of fermions, you get a 4-fermion interaction, and you can do a mean field decoupling. So you get these hopping amplitudes, and you get some pairing. Right? So this is a purely SU2 invariant problem. Of course, these chi's and deltas are not gauge invariant. They are not physical observables. Okay. Now, this kind of a mean field Hamiltonian starting from a Heisenberg model cannot capture magnetic order. It's SU2 invariant. However, in the variational wave function approach, the good thing is that magnetic order can be included by breaking the SU2 symmetry and adding sort of a field with some mean field antiferromagnetic order parameter, and you can induce some magnetic order with some wave vector Q. Right? So the field is zoomed in the x direction. The spins are aligned in the x direction, and the field is sort of taken perpendicular generally to it. So at the mean field level, the constraint is only valid on an average, right? However, the good thing about the Monte Carlo is that you can actually impose the constraint exactly, one fermion per site, and we'll show you how. So this is, of course, not possible to treat analytically, and therefore the problem has to be, thankfully, can be addressed with Monte Carlo. So this mean field Hamiltonian, you have this Lagrange multiplier terms, which enforce the one fermion per site constraint. And it is known that these wave functions actually capture the gap, both the gapped and the gapless phases of the Kitaev compass model are reproduced, and their accuracy has been verified in certain benchmark cases. The thing is that if you work with these generalized wave functions, which have both the generalized Hamiltonians, which are used to generate the wave functions, which have both the mean field part and the magnetic part, is that the moment you have a finite edge in the thermodynamic limit, you know that there is magnetic order. And therefore, it's good to, these are wave functions which study the competition between magnetic order and disorder tendencies. So what you need to do is to do, diagonalize these Hamiltonians, construct a wave function, and then see by optimizing all these parameters, whether the finite edge is indeed stabilized or is not in the thermodynamic limit. Yeah, so you can diagonalize it. Yeah, you just diagonalize it, you get this spectrum, and you get the mean field wave function, which is of course wrong, because it lives in the incorrect Hilbert, which has both double occupancy and empty sites. And we will see now that actually you cannot treat this problem analytically of how to actually go back to the original Hilbert space. You need to do Monte Carlo sampling, configuration by configuration, and remove all the doubly occupied and empty sites, and then you will land up with a strongly correlated wave function. Yeah. Yes. Yeah, so I'll come to that now. So first let me do the case when H is zero. Yes, please. Okay. When H is zero, you have the simple BCS type wave function with these pairing amplitudes. And the exact local constraint is then enforced by Monte Carlo sampling, where you have the Gutzwiller projector, which acts and kills all these doubly occupied sites. Of course, nobody knows analytically till this date what is the effect of the projection. It's like a hard hammer you hit, and then you get something highly non-trivial. But nonetheless, this can be done exactly, and you can land up with a legitimate trial wave function which lives in the correct Hilbert space after the projection. Right? And the good thing is that the Monte Carlo sampling means basically that you're calculating determinants, and as opposed to permanents, which are done in the bosonic representation, determinants can be computed in polynomial time. It's still an open problem, I think, which has a price of $1 million or so, that whether you can compute permanents in polynomial time, but as of now you can't. So the fermionic representation is computationally very nice that you can do that. So this mean field wave function, as I told you, has this BCS form, and these pairing amplitudes are essentially giving you these possibilities for all possible singlet sort of coverings, which are of course overlapping before projection. The effect of the projection is that only non-overlapping coverings of the lattice survive, and you get some sort of a state like this with different amplitudes for different distances of these answers. Yes. Yeah. So the short-range RVP typically refers to spin liquids in which there's a finite gap to the excitations. So, of course. Yeah, I'll come to that. So you can actually systematically classify what are the possible types of couplings that are allowed on the lattice, both short range and for long range RVBs. So short range RVBs, for example, gapped C2 spin liquids, and long range RVBs, which are critical or algebraic spin liquids. You can do a systematic classification, so that I'm coming to. So, yes. Very good point. So yeah, the energy is the first thing that you minimize by the method of steepest descent or more sophisticated versions of it. Yeah, so the point is that this is just a cartoon picture. Xiaogang Wen told us actually how these hoppings and the pairings, the forms of their sign structures on a lattice is a given finite number, say for a class of spin liquids, and what are the all possibilities that can be. So given the crystal symmetry group, say on a square lattice you have C4B, or C6V on the Kagome, and given what kind of a spin liquid you want, Z2, you have a finite, like a zoological classification of all possible beasts and animals. You can actually do a complete classification of it, of what are these allowed ones and what are the forbidden ones. It could be that second neighbor pairings are forbidden, third neighbor are allowed, fifth neighbor hoppings are forbidden. So this whole thing up to all geometric distances, you can actually get by this method of projective symmetry groups. So I'll come to that. So in a cartoon picture, you have these valence bond solids in which you break translational symmetry. Right? You have short-range RBB states in which you have at most say nearest neighbor spins which are forming a singlet, and you have different possibilities which are have a linear combination. And then you have these critical RBB like spin liquids which are represented by this long-range RBB type spin liquids. So. Okay, so let's start in a little more detail about these variational wave functions, which will answer some of your questions. Is that the variational states contain, so the point is that what you have to do is to first define a classical magnetic state. So you take, suppose, some plane, which is the XY plane, and then you have a classical spin, right? So you have some S cosine Q dot R, S sine Q dot R, right? Plus 5 to take care of internal phases. And this is a classical magnetic order, right? Then the question is that if you just treat this magnetic order as you had in the old Hamiltonian here, then this will of course always overestimate the order parameter H because you're not taking into account quantum fluctuations. The standard way to take into account quantum fluctuations is by putting a Jastrow factor. So the Jastrow factor is basically creates out of plane fluctuations like spin waves on top of a classical magnetic state, and this Jastrow factor is explained by Manusakis, essentially reproduces the quantum fluctuations correctly, right? So the only constraint is that all the spins should lie in the same plane. Suppose you have magnetic orders which are non-coplanar, then this construction suffers from difficulty. Non-coplanar orders occur, for example, in non-Bravais lattices like the Kagome lattice, where you have these Q-Bok orders, and then this prescription doesn't behave or give you as good an answer as one would have for coplanar orders. So the classical state is just the simple state where each spin points in a given direction in any plane, let's say the XY plane, and then you know once you specify the Q vector and the phase, the whole magnetic ordering is uniquely specified. So you have this, and these act as the variational parameters, these potentials, and you have to optimize them for every geometrical distance. So if, and these are the variational parameters for the magnetic part along with the H, antiferromagnetic field, which you also have to optimize. So the total wave function consists of the following. You have a mean field wave function, which has these chis and the deltas, which are the hoppings and the pairings. You act on it for a Gajwiller projector, right? And then you also have this Jastrow factor, right? So the variational parameters in the Jastrow factor, these VIJs, which have to be optimized in the Monte Carlo. And then you have these internal chis and the deltas within the, which also have to be optimized. And this psi mean field, for example, could be the ground state of a simple tight binding Hamiltonian. Let's take it for simplicity. And then you have this thing. The trouble is that when you have commensurate or collinear orders, things are fine. You can, you know the Q vector classically and you can specify it. But as you know, when you come down to non-collinear orders, for example, helimagnetic or spiral orders, then as Chubukov showed in 1984, that the first quantum corrections to the ground state are basically that the Q vector gets renormalized and gets shifted to a different value. So, and this can actually be quite strong as you come down to lower spin values. So by starting by a classical Q, you will not get the optimal energy. So first you need to find the optimal Q, which actually gives you the correct, you know, the most accurate ground state. And this combined with the fact that you have periodic boundary conditions and on small systems, your Q points are discretized, leads to some difficulty in treating incommensurate spirals and all of that. Of course, a special case of this is when T is zero and you simply get a bosonic state, right? So the question then arises that how do you choose this mean field Ansart? So how do you choose what are the patterns of hoppings and pairings on a given lattice? Do you just simply start from a random configuration or is there some prescription, right, to do it? Fortunately, we will see that Xiaogang Wen, in his pioneering work of 2002, Quantum Orders and Spin Liquids, actually gave us a prescription that by exploiting this SU2 gate symmetry in the fermionic representation, you're able to systematically classify and enumerate what are the, how many different spin liquids there are and what are their sign structures. So this is not taken from this paper, this is by Samuel Beery's paper, this one. So he shows quantum spin liquids on the triangular lattice respecting rotation symmetries. All lattice symmetries are respected. And then you give spin liquid number 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And then you know, okay, nearest neighbor bond, tau3, which basically real hopping. Second neighbor bond, real hopping and real hopping and real pairing. Third neighbor, real hopping, real pairing, imaginary pairing. Then you come to the next spin liquid, tells you that at nearest neighbor, these are kind. And then when some by symmetry, some amplitude is forbidden, it's a cross. So the Ansar does not have any nearest neighbor hoppings or pairings like that. And then you can systematically enumerate all the Ansarts, right? So for the triangular lattice, you can see that there are 20 spin liquids which you can construct, which have all the symmetries of the lattice and time reversal. And then what you can do is that he gives you the Ansar. So he tells you that this Ansar is like hopping here, right? Then when you rotate, its sign will change. You can figure out the sign by this algebraic relation. Then you rotate here like this, and then you get the full sign structure of each of these Ansarts of nearest neighbor, second nearest neighbor, third nearest neighbor, as you want. On the Kagome lattice also, they showed that there are 20 spin liquids at all, maximum. They, you can also classify what I call as chiral spin liquids, in which you can relax the constraint of time reversal and parity symmetry breaking, and then you land up with a much larger number than 20. So Samuel Beery, Claire Lullier, and Laura Messio, they worked out this PSG classification for chiral states. Well, let me come. So this is as far as the variational wave function is concerned. These variational wave functions are good educated guesses. These are mean field Ansarts. Wen did not tell us that for which Hamiltonian they'll occur as ground states, but he told us at least what all there are. So unless you are remarkably lucky, this will not turn out to be an eigenstate of a Hamiltonian and not the exact ground state. So this can be a good starting point on which you can then systematically improve the answer. So the general thing is that among the community, especially in DMRG, is that this Monte Carlo starts with some bad quality liquid, something like this. And then what you can do is that you can improve the quality of the liquid by applying powers of the Hamiltonian. So in case you're able to apply infinite number of steps, you can land up with some French wines from Bordeaux. And if you are only able to apply a few Langshaw steps, maybe you will land up with some Indian beer. So the technique is that, as Arnab explained, is that you start, so you have this trial wave function that we constructed, and then you apply powers of the Hamiltonian, and then on large clusters, only a few steps can be efficiently implemented. So as he showed that in Langshaw's, you have a tri-diagonal matrix, whose matrix elements you have to compute, and these actually in Monte Carlo can be computed stochastically to some degree of accuracy, these alpha coefficients. And then an estimate of the exact ground state energy can be achieved by method of variance extrapolation. So what happens is that you start from a trial state, you apply one Langshaw step. When you apply one Langshaw step, you reduce the energy and you reduce the variance. Then you apply another Langshaw step, you reduce the energy further, reduce the variance further, and maybe let's with 3 points, you can do an extrapolation to zero variance. And we know that actually when you have an eigenstate, any eigenstate, the variance of the energy is identically zero. So by the method of variance extrapolations, you can get an estimate of the ground state energy. And I'll show you that we did some benchmarking with different models where on small systems, the Langshaw's exact diagonalization is available. So, we want to do some finite size scaling. So as we increase the system size, the calculation of larger and larger powers of the Hamiltonian, the matrix elements, becomes computationally costly. No, it's large in polynomial, but it's still, yeah, you can do it with some parallelization. I know one student who went up to 10 Langshaw steps, you can do it, but it becomes quite cumbersome to do, especially on large system sizes, right, to do this. So for, generally you do up to 2 Langshaw steps, and I'll show you already that you can recover the ED energy within a few error bars. So after working on many lattices, yeah. For ordered phase. Yeah, so for example, in our construction, you can see that whatever magnetic order you wish to test the instability, you can add it in the Hamiltonian by this antiferromagnetic field. And then you can see by size scaling whether the edge remains finite or it goes to zero. I'll show you some results for the triangular lattice. So, yeah. Indeed, precisely, yes. So you are basically also adding, let's say, an ordering tendency or giving order a chance to also basically capture the long-range dipolar ordering tendency in a system by constructing a classical state and putting quantum fluctuations in it, right? So your wave function consists of two parts then, the ordered part and the disordered part, the mean field Hamiltonian. So the order against which you wish to test this thing, that's what you put in. Of course, you are free to put any order, but then you have to see energetically which. So ultimately, spin liquids arise by melting of some parent classical orders, right? So suppose you have a parent order which is 120 degree on the triangular. It melts by frustration. Then generally what we see is that the parent magnetic order's order parameter is actually what you should put in order to get the best energies out. Ultimately, spin liquids, you can imagine for spin 1/2 are a melted version or molten version of the spin going to infinity limit, right? So you, since you know the classical phase diagram, you can then, as you know, what is the choice of the Q vector that you must choose for that order. I'll show it to you in the next slide. So the mother of all wave functions, by which I mean, is that we have seen that on the triangular lattice, on the Kagome lattice, on the honeycomb lattice, and other lattices, a simple tight binding nearest neighbor hopping Hamiltonian with a certain sign structure, which gives you some either pi flux or zero flux distributed on the plaquettes, turns out to actually give you a remarkably good energy. This wave function, as you can see, has no variational parameters. T can be set to plus minus one as the unit. And remarkably, this state having no variational parameters is quite competitive. It's a U1 Dirac spin liquid on the triangular and the Kagome lattices. And it has Dirac points, for example, on the square lattice, you have 4 Dirac points. And it has a power law spin-spin correlation. So in the Kagome lattice, for example, it's 1 over r to the power 4. And this is the an algebraic liquid. Right, so I'll show you some results for all this method. So actually, I must say, the golden era of frustrated magnetism is actually over in some sense. It was the Kagome story. When I entered into PhD, it was at its most hotly debated stage. And the quest for the true spin liquid is not a scientific competition. It was not. It was a full-on war between a gapless tribe and a gapped empire. At that time, the gapped empire was run by Steve White and others, and it has proven to be a quite a traumatic experience for those of us involved in it. Right? It either resulted in true friendships or made lifelong enemies at that stage. So it all started in 2010, later when Steve published this paper, which appeared on the cover. As you see the Kagome lattice on the cover page of Science magazine, claiming that the ground state of the Kagome antiferromagnet is a gapped Z2 spin liquid. Immediately after that, Yuanming Lu did this Xiaogang Wen's PhD classification of Z2 spin liquids for the spin 1/2 Heisenberg on the Kagome lattice and enumerated, told that there are 20 spin liquids that you can have. And he showed perturbatively which of these can be gapped. And he found that no more than 5 spin liquids could be gapped. And remarkably, 4 of these gapped spin liquids could actually be obtained from this state by adding some pairing instabilities on top of it with some sign structure. Not always S wave, but some non-trivial sign structure. And he pointed out one spin liquid, which he called Z2 0 pi beta, you can't see it here, which he says is actually the one found in DMRG. So we immediately worked on it and wrote a paper of projected wave function studies of all these spin liquids and found that indeed for all these gapped states, and in particular to the one that he pointed out, the parameters which are supposed to open the gap, the pairing fields under optimization, all flow to zero, right? And the system goes back to a state which is like this, nearest neighbor tight binding hopping with the Dirac spectrum. And indeed, the moment you take the Dirac state and add some pairing, the energy increases quadratically. And the energy went back to the Dirac state under Monte Carlo optimization. To show it further, we also applied Lanczos steps, as I mentioned to you. So you can start from some trial state, like a U1 Dirac spin liquid, apply one Lanczos step, and you reduce the energy and the variance of the energy, apply two Lanczos steps, and you reach here. And you can do an extrapolation and get an estimate of the ground state energy on, say, a certain cluster. This is about 192 sites. You can do the same for the Z2 spin liquid, which starts from much further off, higher variance, higher energy, and then you can see that it extrapolates to a higher value as compared to the U1 state. And you can do it on various clusters and do a size scaling of the energy in 1 over n, and you get the thermodynamic limit. This is what you get by Monte Carlo, and this is what you get by DMRG. All of these are non-variational estimates because you have involved extrapolation. And you see that the two energies are equal within 3 error bars. For the Higgs boson, they were allowing 5 error bars, so 3 error bars is okay here. So if it's equal within 3, so the first rule in Monte Carlo, when you teach Monte Carlo, the first thing that you teach is that the most important quantity is the error bar. And if two quantities are equal within 3 error bars, they're equal. Okay? So, and then we also calculated, you can also calculate excited states and compute the gap, and we showed that indeed the gap goes to zero. Okay, so then actually DMRG fell in line with Monte Carlo. Yin Chen He, Frank Polman, Mike Zalatel, and Masaki Oshikawa had this very nice paper, Signatures of Dirac Cones in a DMRG Study of the Kagome Heisenberg Model, where they actually did this procedure of adiabatic flux insertion and showed that first of all, unless your cluster has the correct momenta, because DMRG is done on cylinders and you're quantizing your K points, unless you're able to get the correct momenta of the Dirac state, you will always open up a gap and gain the energy. And the second is that you must correctly study it as a function of the adiabatic flux threading in order to see the different topological sectors that you are actually probing for. So they started the DMRG with some boundary condition and inserted this flux, and actually showed how you start with the gap that Steve White had obtained, but then you start closing it. And at some point, they lose this adiabatic continuity and they stop their calculations here. But it shows you how actually the system needs to be tuned in order to get the correct physics. And actually, they plotted the they did a calculation of the transfer matrix spectrum. And in the transfer matrix spectrum, they actually got these beautiful Dirac cones that you see here. And you can compare it with those for free fermions that were in the tight binding model. And this actually found many, many loopholes or things which had not been carefully, seen in the earlier DMRG study. So DMRG in two dimensions is showing its success, but one needs to be really very careful with this choice of geometries and boundary conditions and all of that. Yeah. Yeah, they probed these excitations. I don't remember, but we can look at this paper in detail about that. So similarly, the J1, J2 model in the square lattice, which has been celebrated, when classified 272 symmetric spin liquids, so much larger. So you need a full PhD student and make him suffer for 3 years to go through 272 wave functions and compute the energies. So one student, Wen Junhu, was ready to do it. And Wen Jun actually found that among this 272, there's a particular gapless Z2 spin liquid dubbed something like a meteorite's name, Z2AZZ13, with 4 Dirac points, and it had the most competitive energy. Indeed, on the 6x6, if you do this Monte Carlo, plus 2 Langevin steps and extrapolate, this is the energy you get. And the exact value is this. So you can see how accurate 2 Langevin steps on the correct starting point. So if you know the correct wave function, or nearly correct wave function, then actually you can see that he computed that you 0 Langevin step 1, 2, and you extrapolate, and this is the ED value. You actually get the value within few error bars. But you must have the correct guess. Similarly, he could also compute the spin gap and show that the gap goes to 0 after projection. So the fact this is a gapless spin liquid is a mean field statement. Gudge-Willer projection can completely alter this thing. So you need to recompute the gap for the projected states. And he did it and showed that indeed the gap closes to 0 within certain error bars, which are within tight bounds. Same thing happened on a J1, J2 model on the triangular lattice. There was a case of a pneumatic gapped Z2 spin liquid from DMRG. So this means there is Z2 topological order plus point group symmetry breaking, which was observed in these spin-spin anisotropic correlations. We had this paper where we showed that indeed, on the triangular lattice, you have this 120 degree order and a classical phase transition at point 125, 1 over 8, to stripe antiferro, and a spin liquid opens around this point. And the question is that, what is the nature of the spin liquid? And we showed by this size scaling of this antiferromagnetic parameter H, that when you start for the nearest neighbor model, it's ordered, then you increase frustration, it keeps on going, and then at some point it collapses, which is around 0.08. Collapses, remains 0, and then picks up again on the other side. This is the diagram telling you that there's a spin liquid phase, and this estimation of phase boundaries is in exact agreement with DMRG, within error bars. However, we disagree on the nature of the spin liquid. After doing a lot of Langevin steps, variational optimizations, and size scaling, and everything, we actually agree on the energies and the phase boundaries, but the nature of the spin liquid we don't agree on. There are again 20 spin liquids, and we find that these gapped Z2 pneumatic states are not stabilized as the ground states. Indeed, the best variational wave function is one when all these pairings go to 0, and the energy goes back to that of the Dirac spin liquid. So again, the Dirac spin liquid, which has no variational parameters, seems to be the most competitive on many lattices. You can also compute dynamical structure factor with VMC, which has recently been achieved. Basically, the definition of the dynamical structure factor is this, and you can actually create 2 spin-on triplet excitations with some momenta Q by the projection of the simple particle hole excitations of the BCS spectrum. And then each momentum Q, this Q and R defines a basis set that can be used to approximate the low energy excitations. And these coefficients can be actually obtained by diagonalizing. This is a simple eigenvalue problem of obtaining these coefficients. in terms of overlap matrices and the matrix sort of elements. And the dynamical structure factor can be computed by taking a sum at most L states. Of course, you cannot take an exponentially large number of states in a variational calculation. And then instead of using the exact ground state and the exact excited states, you can use the variational states, the energies of the variational states. The good thing is that all quantities that define the S of Q, omega can be computed within a VMC scheme without any sign problem. And indeed, for the J1, J2 Heisenberg chain, for which you know the, you create two spin-on excitations. And then, of course, the Gutzwiller projection then can do anything on top of that. And it has been shown that it can also reproduce a multi-magnon excitation after projection. But the thing is that you are simply creating excitations at a certain momentum, certain Q value, by creating simple particle hole excitations of the BCS spectrum, right? And you can see that for the J1, J2 chain, for which we know the exact result, you have spin-ons, as Yogesh pointed out and others, that you with VMC, you basically reproduce the exact Langshaw's result on a 30-site spin chain. You can overlay it both quantitatively and qualitatively. And here I show for different quantum numbers, excited states, the overlap between this is the Langshaw's in red and the blue is the Monte Carlo result. Very high degree, you can get the 1D Luttinger liquid features as well as the gapped and the incommensurate features that come when you are at 0.5. Same thing you can do on the square lattice, and you reproduce this magnon branch at pi, and then as the frustration increases, you can see how the excitations at 0 pi 0 start gapping out, and you can see this observance of this continuum at higher frequencies energies. Okay, so this is one part of the talk where I showed you the VMC. Now I'm running out of time, so I'll come to another method which has proven also extremely powerful in addressing the low temperature physics of many frustrated magnetic Hamiltonians. Its principal attractiveness lies in the fact that it scales very well to when you want to do three-dimensional quantum magnets, in which many recently synthesized compounds are coming up. And there are many models which have also theoretically not been investigated beyond spin wave theory, right? Like pyrochlores and other things. So I'll come to the other thing, which is of the functional renormalization group, which carries the same spirit as the VMC. In that you rewrite the spin operators in terms of abacus of fermions. What the VMC did was to do a mean field decoupling, where you decoupled in terms of the spin mean field and you had the hopping and the pairing. And then starting from this mean field and by putting projection and Jastrow factors and all of that, you try to go beyond mean field and add fluctuations and create a strongly correlated wave function. The FRG is a more bolder attempt. It wants to treat this full four fermion interaction in its full complexity. Now, this is a really complicated problem. So the reason for rewriting in terms of fermions is that you can do diagrammatics. So the propagator in Matsubara space takes a simple spin independent form, which is just 1 over I omega. There is no self energy here at the beginning, because of course you don't have any quadratic term in the Hamiltonian. This is a rather peculiar situation. And then you have some interaction vertex, which is these couplings at high energy. The point is that since there is no small parameter, a self-consistent infinite order diagrammatic summation needs to be performed. So already Anderson showed in 1971 that, for example, in the case of this orthogonality catastrophe, that your wave functions which are perturbed by a local sort of potential are orthogonal to the unperturbed wave function when the number of particles goes to infinity. And he showed that conventional perturbation theory fails, and you must, later it was Zalushinsky and Larkin who showed that you must do an infinite order resummation of in order to get any reasonable results. So the FRG is a bold attempt of trying to do an infinite order diagrammatic summations in different interaction channels. So the first thing is that you put in some cutoff, some infrared frequency cutoff, which removes all modes below a certain energy scale. The consequence is that all vertex functions become lambda dependent. Self energy, you have the two particle vertex, the three particle vertex, and so on till. No, it keeps up to, so it removes, so it's a heavy side step function, right? So you are slowly reducing the lambda, including more and more modes at lower and lower energies as the flow goes on. So in the limit lambda goes to infinity, you basically have just left with the bare Heisenberg couplings, right, that you have. And then the FRG tries to formulate differential equations for all these vertex functions. This mapping is, of course, exact. However, its numerical solution is not exact because it's an infinite hierarchy of coupled equation. So what happens is that you have the self energy and you can do an expansion in the couplings and then take a derivative with respect to the cutoff parameter lambda. And fortunately, the right-hand side actually can be resummed and you basically get the FRG equation, for example, for the self energy. Similarly, you do an expansion in the couplings for the two particle vertex and then you can again do a resummation and get the flow equation for the two particle. You can go on and do it for the three particle, the four, the five, up to infinite. But of course, in a real calculation, the number of these equations really grows a lot and you must do some truncation. So what we do is that we truncate the three particle vertex. Of course, we don't completely kill it, but certain self-energy corrections are taken back into account and fed back into the two particle vertex, which goes by the name of Katanin truncation. Because he showed at the two loop level how you can actually do this. But there are two types of feedbacks you can do, vertex corrections and self-energy corrections. So these are self-energy corrections, which basically means that you replace the single scale propagator by the full derivative of the lambda-dependent Green's functions. Right? And then you can show that the Ward identities are slightly better fulfilled. But of course, there's still an approximation. What this means is that since you don't compute the three particle vertex, chiral correlations are not included in the system. Okay, so the FRG starts with some lambda goes to infinity where your vertex is just the bare coupling and ends at lambda equals zero, numerically not at zero, but at some finite cutoff, which is typically 2 to 3 orders of magnitude smaller than the coupling. And then you solve the differential equations for the full frequency dependence, say 100 discretized points. You get up to a few thousand sites. And these are about 10 to the power 7 coupled integral differential equations, which need to be solved numerically. And then you can calculate the magnetic response. So as of now, you can actually calculate the static susceptibility, that is the susceptibility at zero frequency. Tobias Müller, who's sitting here, the brilliant PhD student, he's working on trying to extend FRG to actually calculate dynamical structure factors in the Keldysh formalism. That is, he's actually already reformulated the entire FRG in terms of the basically on the real frequency axis. He's working right now on numerics of doing that, and then you don't need any analytical continuation, all of that, to get the dynamics. So if you want to talk about that, he's the person you should catch. So the FRG sums up diagrammatic contributions in infinite order in J. So you have the particle-particle ladder, you have the particle-hole ladder, and then you have the RPA diagrams, which are these bubbles. And then you have vertex corrections. These are extremely important because if you have divergences in one channel, they can get regularized by the other. So these vertex corrections turned out to be incredibly important. And you can actually make some pair similarity with the Monte Carlo. These particle-particle ladder are simply the pairing amplitudes. The particle-hole ladder are like the hopping amplitudes. And this term generates long-range dipolar magnetic order. So if you kill all terms and keep only this, you recover back the standard spin RPA, in which all diagrams to leading order in 1 over S are summed up exactly, right? So you have the ladder graphs, which basically give you the dimer states, and then the RPA graphs, which give you magnetic order. So order and disorder tendencies are treated on an equal footing. You can show that these ladder diagrams are indeed the leading contributions in a 1 over N expansion. So you can precisely show this, that to leading order in 1 over N, where N is the generalization of the spin symmetry group, you recover back the exact result. Similarly, to leading order in 1 over S, the FRG is systematically, it's exact, okay? And the neglected three particle vertices are basically the subleading contributions in 1 over N or 1 over S. So the order and disorder tendencies are equally included in one loop FRG. We also now have a formulation of two loop FRG, and its implementation has again been done by Tobias, where you can improve upon many of these. Now, many of you would wonder, and people have asked time and again, how do you treat the constraint? Well, there are two ways. You can do it either by the Popov-Fedotov method, where you put an imaginary chemical potential uniformly over the lattice, And then you can show that, that you basically can impose this one fermion per side constraint. Or you can do it by adding level repulsion terms so that the states, you know, which are empty or doubly occupied basically are higher in energy, and the states, others, you select only states which are in the original Hilbert space. However, we adopt the strategy of putting chemical potential equals to zero, which enforces the constraint on average and is mostly sufficient. Indeed, Johannes Reuter showed that suppose you take the RG flow of the susceptibility versus temperature, and as you go down, the Fedotov-Popov method and the average actually nearly coincide. The difference between them actually is not much. So at low temperatures, you shouldn't worry about that. We are not only restricted to spin one half, we can go on to do larger spins by creating multiple copies of spin one halves on every site. And by adding level repulsion terms, you can select the spin magnitude which is the largest. And this basically amounts to a simple change in the flow equations that each fermion loop then acquires a factor of 2s. In terms of RG flow equations remain basically the same. You just need to add the correct prefactors in the different such that when the spin length goes to infinity, you're only left with the RPA contribution and you get a classical magnetic order, right? So for example, the most celebrated example is that nearest neighbor Heisenberg model in the pyrochlore lattice at large S, which is very special because you can rewrite the Hamiltonian as a squared sum of the magnetization on every tetrahedron, and the ground state is trivially one, in which this vector sum is zero for classical spins. And this actually then gives rise to very beautiful features in the structure factor, such as pinch points and the singularities which Jason showed and others talked about these pinch, which are just a Fourier transform of the dipolar correlations that comes with the solenoidal field that is there. So this is actually done with FRG. So we collectively reproduce the large S limit. You can see that the FRG here reproduces exactly the same structure factor as was calculated by many other studies in this classic nice. The Kagome-Heisenberg antiferromagnet is another celebrated example, as I said. Where the FRG has been applied. Indeed, the susceptibility does not show any divergence down to zero temperature, indicating a quantum paramagnet. And the susceptibility in this extended Brillouin zone shows peaks at the corner. You can see the similarity with DMRG here on this. Recently, it has been extended to add a Zaluzhinsky-Moria interaction. It was shown that actually when you add the Zaluzhinsky-Moria interaction, at some point you select a long-range magnetically ordered state, which is the Q equals zero state on the Kagome lattice, which has peaks at the centers of the sides of the Brillouin zone. And it was shown by Johannes Reuter and Max Herring that actually you need about 10% DM interaction to drive the system from a spin liquid to a magnetically ordered state around here. That's when the divergences start appearing in the flow. And the RG flow. So around 10% is the critical value. It has been estimated from ESR studies and also ED comes to the same, roughly the same estimate of the critical. I know there are other estimates by tensor networks, by Ying-Jer, who's there in the audience, who claim that a much smaller amount of DM interaction, about an order of magnitude smaller, is enough to drive the system. So this is an open question about So now I come to the last part of my talk, which is actually showing the power of the FRG in synthesizing theory and experiment. So the way we have been working recently is that you have these interesting 3D candidate spin liquid materials. From the theoretical side, ab initio density functional theory can determine these couplings J, and they then act as the input to the FRG, which calculates the spin structure factor, and then you compare it with neutron scattering on single crystals when available. And you can also, of course, compute powder averages. You just have to integrate that, right? And then you reach some conclusions. Yeah. Yeah, so on the pyrochlore, that's right. We are able to reach 12 lattice spacings, 12 distance of 12 in units of the nearest neighbor lattice spacing. It's almost impossible to catch an algebraic decay with compared to, you know, of a high power compared to an exponential, as you know. So we have not yet been able to resolve that issue of between algebraic and DK is an exponential sort of, you know, DK is that clearly for you because of various things. One of which is what you mentioned about system sizes, and there are some other issues I can point to why this has not yet been very clearly resolved. So this compound is actually, I think, one of the most promising material in 3D, which by all materials are in 3D, but here, of course, you cannot construct a sort of decoupled layer type of a picture, where the system, which is predominantly so based on the spins being provided by the Cu2 plus ions, and no static magnetism has been observed down to 0.02 Kelvin, okay, despite a Curie-Weiss temperature, which in magnitude is 22 Kelvin. So this points to dominant antiferromagnetic interactions. And this forms a very interesting lattice, which is actually a deformation of the hypercargome, which Yogesh showed, that it is just a 3D twist of the ideal cargome, and it's been dubbed the hyper-hypercargome. I'll try to justify why this is, although I don't understand it very well. If you take the pyrochlore lattice, then as Yogesh showed, that you can do a depletion of these sites and land up with these triangles which are corner sharing, and then you get this this hypercargome structure which has been classified in this space group P4132. And then along certain symmetry axis, you can actually do some kind of a distortion along these axes, difficult to show, where you can create a distortion of this hypercargome while keeping the symmetry. I actually still don't know of any other example where you can do a distortion and don't change the symmetry. Okay, and then you get this hypercargome with these additional dangling triangles. So this is like a hypercargome with isolated triangles which are just hanging around there. So they create additional frustration because you are unable to satisfy the constraint of zero spin sum per tetrahedron. So this is how the, yeah. Yeah, only the connectivity of the lattice. So here you see that, so these triangles are smaller than these, so the nearest neighbor coupling then exists on these isolated dangling triangles. These are the original hypercargome triangles. So if you remove this nearest neighbor coupling and keep only J2, you recover back the ideal hypercargome. Okay? So in terms of neighbors, it has up to fourth neighbor couplings like this. So the frustrating couplings are the J1 and the J2s. These actually J3s and J4 are basically chain couplings which run parallel to the cubic unit cell axis or diagonally, body diagonally. So they are not the frustrating one. The frustrating is J1 and J2. Right? And a collaborator, Harald Yeshke, did ab initio DFT calculations and calculated the magnetic Hamiltonian. So basically the DFT couplings are the function of U. And then you can fix which ones to use by fixing the Curie-Weiss temperature, because we know the Curie-Weiss temperature is minus 22 Kelvin. So we chose a set of couplings which basically reproduces the Curie-Weiss temperature. So the ratio of the couplings is like this. J1 is nearly comparable to J2. J3 is about 1/2, and then J4 is small, but still, yeah. Oh, yes, okay. That's a good point. I mean, we don't know. Of course, DM interaction is committed on this because there's lack of inversion symmetry. I don't know, so Yogesh will correct me if I'm wrong, but you need ESR experiments to get this DM, right? So, but ESR I don't think has been done on it yet. But our purpose was to show that a simple isotropic Hamiltonian, isotropic in spin space, will actually reproduce the neutron features remarkably well. So, it'll just be isolated triangles, I don't know, it'll just be isolated triangles which are not talking to each other. Yeah, sure. Yeah, of course, you can exactly solve it by pen and paper. That's there. Yeah. So the neutron scattering pictures are these. So in neutrons, you probe, for example, the HHL plane, which is the kx equals to ky plane in momentum space. And this is the picture that you get by neutrons. This was done by Bella Lake and Shravani Chillal. You basically see these two lobes of strong intensity, which we have come to a microscopic understanding of why you have these streaks. This arises because of actually, and these are the FRG calculations, and these basically arise because these are lines of high degeneracy in the parent classical spin liquid, which is not, which is sub-extensively degenerate. And this is the plot in the HK0 plane, where you see this picture and these two little lobes that arise. And in FRG, if you do, you actually recover, you see these two tiny lobes and all of that. And then on a more accurate footing, you basically, suppose you plot the experimental data, which is averaged over this region along this line, which is given basically in these blue points with these error bars, and you do the FRG, which is a red curve, and you see how overlapping they are. So the FRG is able to reproduce this little double hump that is seen in experiment. And the same thing in the HK0 plane. The blues are the experimental raw data points where you basically have this little two humps if you go along the horizontal direction. And this is the FRG calculations that I did and then you see you recover exactly. This is a quite remarkable agreement, a quantitative agreement of results, not just qualitative. And this is a fully three-dimensional calculation. And as of now, there does not exist any other method which can do a full 3D quantum many-body calculation, despite all the shortcomings that FRG has in its terms of. So we can explain these actually things by going to a classical picture with these couplings and trying to understand what is the parent classical state. And this is there in our paper on the archive. You can have a look at it. And then we add quantum fluctuations and we can see how these streaks of classical spin liquids basically go into the quantum picture. So I'll come to the conclusion of my talk, in which I'll try to show you what is the power and the weakness of the functional RG method. So the FRG allows you to investigate an arbitrary two-spin Hamiltonian. So many types of interactions, so Heisenberg, Zelushinsky, Moria, Kitaev, XXZ, long-range J, dipolar, whatever you want. So as of now, we have developed Heisenberg, Zelushinsky, Moria, XXZ, Kitaev. The trouble comes in getting these gamma terms that are there in the symmetric. You can do 2 and 3D lattices. In fact, also Tobias did a 4D lattice, hypercube, just to check. So it also works in 4D reasonably well, right? That systems, 2000, even you can push it even more. We have pushed it before to about 3,000, 4,000 sites. Spin is not a problem. You can do arbitrary spin. So all these pyrochlores with higher spin that are coming into picture, spin 1, spin 3, half breathing pyrochlores, these chromium spinels, you know, oxides, selenides, sulfides, which we are. I'll give a talk on the breathing pyrochlores on Sunday, in which I'll talk about these compounds. I didn't include one part, which is a recent development of FRG, which is merging Venn's PSG with the low energy vertex, where you can take the low energy vertex from FRG and do self-consistent mean field and try to extract these hoppings and the pairings and link it to the tables that Venn gives, which spin liquid it is. A dimerization, valence bond crystals, I didn't talk about it, but we have done spin pneumatics, quadrupolar order, all of that can be done. So any symmetry breaking, either in spin space or real space is not a problem. Spin pneumatics we actually found on the square lattice. When you frustrate ferromagnetic couplings, you can have these magnon bound states, and therefore you can have some spin pneumatics that are formed, as the Nick Shannon showed. We've extended this to two-loop FRG. The problem that comes is that couplings beyond two-body interactions cannot be treated as of now. This is simply computational requirements because the three-particle matrix, as you can see, is already a function of 5 frequencies. And we treat 100 frequencies, so the algorithm scales as omega cube. And 100 over p cube, then everything blows up. We cannot do symmetric gamma interactions. As of now, they are quite difficult to implement, but we are working on this. So Tobias can tell you more. He's calculating the dynamical structure factor, but we don't have any results as of now, but this is ongoing work. And 1D systems are not accessible due to technical reasons of the balance between ordering and disordering diagrams being disturbed. These are my collaborators. So much of the work would not have been sort of possible without Tobias and Pratyay. Pratyay is my postdoc in Madras, and Tobias is a PhD student with Ronnie and me. Max Herring, who is Johannes Reuter's PhD student. So first of all, thanks to the three of them for all the hard work. Then Johannes Reuter, from whom I learned Functional RG and Ronnie, both of whom, Jonas, Michelle, Jingra, Stefan. For variational Monte Carlo, I've collaborated over the last decade with the following people, my PhD advisor, Didier, Sandro, and a lot with Federico. And we've had great help with the DFT people, Igor Mazin, Harald Yeshke, Jose Valenti, who are always available to you know, resolve the couplings in the compounds we are most interested in. And then thank you for your attention.
Okay, I have a question. So imagine if for your FRG, can you like or have you guys tested for benchmark against some simple, well-defined exact solvable model like a Kitai model?
Yeah.
Can FRG produce the exact result?
Yeah, this is a paper in 2011 or so by Johannes and Ronnie, where they reproduced the phases of the Kitaev model, the Kitaev Heisenberg model. It's a paper by Simon Trips, Johannes Reuter, and Ronnie Tomale. That's one of the first applications they did to the Kitaev model. Yeah, they have done it, so you can check that work out. You're putting me into trouble, but yes, we are working on it. So I think what you're referring to is on the pyrochlor lattice. So yeah, so in 2D square lattice, Nick Shat at one time was very interested in this work on spin nematics by frustrating ferromagnetism. And they, with ED, principally with ED and some other, I think, method, I don't remember, they put out some phase diagram. And we actually have a reasonably good agreement with this thematic picture for the XZ models that we investigated on that line. So yeah, you reproduce the S wave pneumatic, the D wave pneumatic, S pneumatic. Of course, qualitative agreement between the phases, but there is qualitative. On the square lattice, of course, also is well reproduced.
Any more questions from the audience? So for this hyper-hyper Kagame lattice, is there any, you know, ab initio calculation of these exchanges?
Well,
although they are not quite reliable, but maybe can give you some hint.
Well, the proof of the pudding lies in its eating. So it's here.
There are too many feeding parameters, right? So
it's not equal to 7, it's still 4. So what I did was to tweak these couplings, as he said. So even if I vary them by actually 20%, I find that the structure factor only changes quantitatively, not qualitatively. So maybe if someone does a full mapping of the phase diagram in this general space, it seems that the spin liquid is rather robust in the sense that it's located in the deep inside a paramagnetic region. So we tweaked around with these couplings a lot, trying to test that.
Okay.
So some results are there. There's an older paper which did perturbative calculations for these couplings. There the results are unreliable because then they don't compare at all to neutron scattering. So in the appendix of this paper, I take the old couplings obtained not by DFT but by some perturbation theory and then calculate the structure and it's totally off. So it seems that things work.
Yeah. So if there's no question, let's conclude this section and thank the speaker again. So there will be a tea break outside.